Well, welcome, Eric. We've got a great treat today. We're going to be talking about capitalism, the evil socialism, breaking some myths, and talking about wealth and income inequality and all these interesting topics. So, Eric, why don't you introduce a little bit about yourself, and so some of our viewers can get a better idea of your background and what brings you into this world.
Okay. So my name is Eric Schoenberg. I have a PhD from and teach in the psychology department at Columbia University. But I'm really more of a behavioral economist. I have a background as an investment banker. I spent a decade working as an investment banker and became very interested in financial markets, but from a psychological perspective. I was a banker in technology in the 90s, which was a fascinating time. Of course, there was the internet bubble. And I became so interested in that, I decided I wanted to study it. So one aspect of my academic work is around decision-making in financial markets, and particularly with regards to bubbles, situations where asset prices go crazy. In addition, about 20 years ago, I got involved with public policy work around tax policy. There's a gentleman by the name of Chuck Collins, who I believe was the founder of an organization up in Boston called Responsible Wealth. But around 2000, 2001, he was working with Bill Gates Sr., that is to say Bill Gates' father, on a project around the estate tax, trying to strengthen it, reinforce it, make sure it didn't go away, which was the threat at the time. So I became involved with their efforts, first lobbying on Capitol Hill in Washington. And since then, I've spent the last 20 years, you know, around tax issues affecting the wealthy. My particular interest is around estate and inheritance taxes, but I'm certainly interested in a number of other issues. So I combine sort of an academic approach to these problems based in psychology with a more practical, real world connection, both via my career experience as well as my political work.
Interesting. I was familiar with your work with tax reform and Patriot Millionaires, the organization you're part of as well. I didn't quite realize you were involved in this space for so long. I'd love to jump into that more a little later, but first let's lay a little foundation, I think, and break down, just because there's a lot of anger right now with the current system, and a lot of folks are just calling it pure capitalism, but I think we might agree it's not exactly pure capitalism. So if you could break down for us, what is capitalism, what is socialism, and then how would you classify or characterize the system we're currently operating in?
So I'm happy to respond. I should note, again, I'm not technically an economist, and the kind of questions you're asking are really economics-type questions. So I'll give you my perspective, but I'm not going to claim this is some kind of authoritative viewpoint.
Yes, of course.
So capitalism, I mean, yes, there is a lot of confusion because often these terms are not very well defined. And more importantly, they're not categorically different. You know, you can have socialist concepts within a capitalist system. So let's begin with, you know, the core concept of capitalism, which is simply the accumulation of capital, the accumulation of savings that in theory and in practice allows you to grow the economy. So at heart, that's all capitalism is. Capitalism is about the accumulation of capital, with the theory being that as we accumulate capital, our ability to produce goods and services becomes more efficient, more effective, and everybody benefits because the economy grows. Now, layered on top of that is the notion of free market capitalism, or really private property capitalism, which is in America and historically, you know, capitalism is associated with the private ownership of those accumulated savings. And so communism, which you didn't ask me about, but communism, as originally formulated by Karl Marx and further elucidated by guys like Vladimir Lenin, but again, I emphasize, not necessarily a coherent set of beliefs that everybody agrees about, But at the heart of communism is the idea of moving away from purely private ownership of property. At an extreme, no private ownership of property whatsoever. True communism would be all property is owned collectively or by the state. Socialism is one of those wiggle terms that was really, I think, developed to avoid the bad press that communism had gotten. Now, of course, socialism has the same kind of bad press. So I don't really like the term myself. I mean, what I say I am is a capitalist. Absolutely. I believe in capitalism. I think it is a good system. I do not think, however, that completely unfettered free market capitalism is the best system. There is ultimately no such thing. From the very start, government behavior, laws, rules, regulations have always been a major factor in the way even a purely capitalist system has evolved. And so at the core of my argument is just the simple idea that this idea that to have a truly capitalist system, you can't have government involved at all. I think it's empirically wrong. It's just not historically correct. Government has always been involved. And I think it needs to be involved because somebody needs to set the rules of the road. So in my view, I am simply arguing for a more realistic and practical form of capitalism to take into account this basic observation that capitalism does seem to have an inherent tendency towards greater and greater levels of inequality, which is to say capitalist systems seem to have mechanisms by which the rich get richer, the poor get poorer, and unless somebody steps in to set the rules somewhat differently, that process will reach a very unfortunate end. So that's my view of the main distinctions we're talking about. So the real issue is not capitalism versus socialism. It's capitalism with one set of rules versus capitalism with a different set of rules. We're really just arguing about what are the rules by which we play the game.
And so before we jump into the current rules we're operating in, you just said you don't believe in unfettered capitalism. And so can you dive into that a little bit more and explain what are you against in that framework?
Like, well, let me repeat. It's not so much that I'm against it. I don't believe it exists. There has never been a capitalist system that does not involve legal rules that are set by some central authority. It simply has never been observed. And there are, you know, there's an old joke about communism. You know, communism hasn't failed. It just hasn't really been tried. I mean, there's some who try to argue that I'm right, that it's never been tried. But if it were tried, it would work beautifully. Well, that's a fantasy world. And so again, it's just a question of what are the rules in place, you know, and now turning to the practicalities of what I view in America. Again, somebody's going to set the rules. There are going to be rules, and those rules are going to serve to benefit, you know, some group. The problem with the system we have in place is that the rules are basically determined by the rich, and they set those rules to make the rich get richer. So let me give you a concrete example that has been one of my particular obsessions, which is in the American tax system, people such as me who get the majority of their income from capital, from investments via dividends and capital gains, pay lower tax rates than people such as yourself who get the majority of their income from labor. This is a choice. This is not, there's not some abstract question here. There's a practical question of how are you going to tax things. The argument has been, well, you don't want to tax capital because capital is good, et cetera, et cetera. But the practical impact of this system has been that anybody with money finds it easier to accumulate more money than somebody without money. I mean, again, my observation is, look, I think inequality is a problem. I think there are a lot of underlying reasons why inequality has grown. But can we at least start by agreeing that government should stop making the problem worse? Under our current tax system, the government makes that particular problem worse.
And so how do you think we got here? Because for many decades, since around the Gilded Age, roughly, we were trending towards less inequality. And then we began trending in the current trajectory we've been in for quite a while now. And so in your mind, what did we do right to break down the inequality and merge it a bit more? And what have we done wrong since then?
Right. So again, to the extent that anyone has argued that, you know, free market, laissez-faire capitalism is the best system, they often will point to 19th century America, which admittedly did see enormous economic growth rates, as their example that it occurred and that it was good. Well, let's first of all make clear, in mid-19th century America, the government was deeply involved in economic growth and deeply involved in benefiting certain parties. For example, the railroads, which were a very major part of economic growth at that time, the railroads were granted huge amounts of land in the United States as basically a way for them to fund the development of railroads. This was an active government policy. The idea that, oh, you know, government wasn't doing anything, just letting the railroads do their thing, it's just not true. And then secondly, as you noted, what happened as a result of that system was, not surprisingly, if you're going to give huge amounts of money to railroad entrepreneurs to allow them to build the railroads, you're going to see some very rich railroad entrepreneurs. So we saw this enormous increase in inequality of wealth. You know, fortunes such as that of Cornelius Vanderbilt or John D. Rockefeller. I mean, the equivalent fortune today of John D. Rockefeller would be something like $300 billion. I mean, it's just an astronomical amount. So, what changed? Well, due to a lot of different factors and ultimately a lot of political pressure, the Progressive Era succeeded in putting in place an income tax, which hadn't existed previous to 1917, except for brief periods during the Civil War. Putting in place estate taxes, same thing, didn't really exist prior to the First World War. Putting in place laws and regulations around monopolies and trusts, which had been a significant factor in increasing the wealth of the very richest. And then finally, putting in place regulations to protect consumer well-being around things like a meatpacking industry that considered a bunch of rats thrown into the meat is just kind of the part of the price you paid for the system. So there were a whole host of issues, a whole host of policies that were put in place from the beginning of the 20th century right up into the New Deal era. And it seems to be the case, although there is still debate about it, that that was a major factor in the compression of inequality into the latter part of the 20th century. So if you look at graphs of the growth of inequality, which again is a little hard to measure, but you see this incredible increase that keeps widening into the 1920s. And then as the 1930s roll around into the 40s, 50s, and 60s, that there is a significant compression. The rich are not nearly as astronomically rich during that period. During the 1980s, beginning with the Reagan Revolution, which was in large part an attempt to reinsert a tax system that benefited the wealthy again, it has widened tremendously. And now, I noted a moment ago, if you took John D. Rockefeller's wealth at the beginning of the 20th century and tried to convert it as a percentage of the GNP into current wealth, as I said, it would be around a $300 billion fortune, which is astronomical. On the other hand, Jeff Bezos became the first man actually worth $200 billion in nominal terms earlier this year. And he's certainly on target to exceed John D. Rockefeller as the richest American ever. It certainly looks like we are entering a second Gilded Age with a new set of ultra wealthy people. And a large part of my political work has been around the idea that I don't think this is good, both for society as a whole, and frankly, for those people themselves.
You know, I wanted to ask this later, but I think now's a great time, and we can manage and work with the tax system or labor unions and all these things. And for me as an outsider, it feels more like battling with powerful stakeholders, because they're the lobbying, it's very easy if you have a lot of money and wealth to change policy. Whereas if you're just the working poor, the middle class, it's more challenging to change legislation and policy. How do we incentivize the system to be more focused on vitalizing the middle class and focusing on that as the engine for the economy, as opposed to this fairly neoliberal trickle down economics of just make the rich richer, and then that will be a very healthy system, which it appears that is not exactly how it works. How do we incentivize the system to vitalize the middle class?
You can't incentivize a system.
I guess how do you incentivize the people within the system?
It gets a little more complicated. It's better to think of incentivizing individuals. Mm-hmm. And in fact, there is this debate in economics now. Well, it's really political economics. There is this theory called the median voter theorem. And the median voter theorem basically is asking the question you're asking, which is, look, if people care about inequality, and you're in a situation of rising inequality, well, that should lead to voters voting on the basis of trying to reduce inequality. If that's my preference and I observe that it's growing, then I'm going to vote for politicians that are going to take actions to change that. And I think, you know, the fundamental problem is we're realizing that some of our conceptions about political and voting behavior are flawed. So for one thing, there's a lot of people who now believe or recognize that voters do not vote purely on their economic self-interest. They vote on a lot of other issues, and in particular, they frequently vote on cultural issues, and it seems to be the case that they weigh the cultural issues as being more important to them than tax policy. And I will go further. I mean, let me just reinforce that point by saying, you know, I as somebody who's been involved arguing for higher taxes on rich people for a long time, it is noteworthy to me that all of the polling data suggests that the policies I am proposing and endorsing are in fact highly popular policies. There was even a poll that was done of people, self-reported supporters of the Tea Party, right? Which we always think of as, you know, very conservative people. But even a majority of self-reported supporters of the Tea Party thought taxes should be raised on people with an income of more than $1 million. So you're sort of asking the question of, well, why don't those people vote in favor of politicians who actually endorse those policies? And point one is the cultural element, but I want to point to point two, because it's my belief. I mean, it's certainly the case that the wealthy are able to have a much bigger influence on the political debate simply because of their money. I mean, it's very easy for me to get calls returned from senators and congressmen. You know, I get calls from them all the time. I mean, just the fact that they want donations gives you an inherent amount of access. And I think that is definitely part of the problem. But I actually point to an even deeper problem, which is I think that one thing the right or these advocates of what I call free market fundamentalism have done very effectively with their funds is support academics. Because many of our beliefs are driven by the theories that people in academia tell us are true. If somebody that you trust as an intellectual tells you, you know, if you raise taxes, you're going to make the economy worse, how do you know that that's Not true. And so the conservatives have been, the right wing has been very effective in building an intellectual infrastructure around this argument that anytime the government interferes, they make things worse. And that is a very difficult mindset to get around. I have a friend who teaches at Harvard and did this very interesting research study where what he did was, he was also interested in the estate tax, and he was interested in, you know, why the estate tax is not a very popular tax, and he was interested in why and how you could move that around. And so one of his ideas was people don't realize how bad inequality has gotten. And so one thing he did was he said, well, what if we gave people information about how bad inequality has gotten? Would that increase their support for example, estate taxes? And the answer is, no, it doesn't. And his thesis about why it doesn't is because if the information you're giving people is, boy, inequality has really gotten bad over the last 30 years, it just keeps getting worse and worse, most people take that piece of information and they think to themselves, oh man, the government is really screwed up to let that happen. So if you then turn to them and say, well, you know, here's a government policy that might reverse that, the problem is they also look at that and they go, but if government was the reason the problem got bad in the first place, why would I trust the government to fix it? So it is the combination of creating this belief system around free market fundamentalism, as well as reinforcing this message of government incompetence, that turns out to be, I think, the biggest, those are the two big impediments to behave, to change. You have to believe that the change you have to believe that what I'm saying, hey, we should raise estate taxes. You have to believe, A, that's actually going to accomplish the goal you want. It's going to lower inequality. And B, the government is going to implement it in such a way that you're actually going to get that effect. And again, having done a lot of tax issue, one thing that is very clear to me is people definitely have the feeling, hey, we can raise taxes all we want on the rich, but they'll figure a way to get around it. They'll figure out a way to get around it. And as you know, as somebody who deals with these issues myself, it's, yeah, rich people are really smart in figuring out how to get around the tax system, but it's not as straightforward as people seem to think. It's not an invariable and inevitable part of the world. There are definitely ways we can address that. There are a lot of ways we can address it. But unless you have some fundamental belief that the government is going to be capable of doing it, you're just never going to want to start.
Yeah. And you know, the 2 points you made of the conservatives being super good at dictating narrative of what is good or bad or what's happening here. And then also mentioning the giving the data out of like, well, look, inequality is bad and it's not really changing minds. I thought this actually speaks a lot to what we do with this project. And I thought a lot about this. I have an analogy of, it's like the climate debate. A lot of these experts and data scientists are super, and lots of folks that even aren't, they're very passionate about, well, we need to really take action now. And so what they do is they just double down on data and science, and they just put these reports and analysis information out there. It's like, you don't get it. Look at these numbers. And I see that. I'm like, you know, that it's a losing battle. It's narrative, it's story, it's emotion, it's people, it's connection. And conservatives are very good at understanding that and dictating that narrative. And so I guess it's exactly, you pinned it on the head. That's what, when I probably botched the question by saying incentivize the system, what I'm really referring to is this, is how do we create a narrative that incentivizes the policies that could perhaps lower inequality. So it's not that battling a narrative or battling a system. The narrative is, you know what, inequality is destabilizing, and here's ways that actually make my life more stable, your life more stable, and all of our lives more vibrant and economically productive. And so That's at least what we're trying to do with this program, is change narrative. And so I guess that's the big question, is how has narrative changed, right, with these tax policies?
So not surprisingly, I fully agree. I mean, I tell my students all the time, you know, people, if you want to make a compelling argument to somebody, facts are not the core thing. It's create a story that resonates with them. Now, I want to talk about one thing that I think is particularly important, right? You know, one of the story, I also believe, let me be clear. I have seen zero evidence that most voters vote on the basis of what they think is going to benefit them directly. I mean, it seems logical. Well, how could you not be voting for what you think is good for you? Well, there's a lot of reason to think, no, I don't think they actually do that. I think people vote for candidates that they think are on the side of people like me. Now notice, that's not me. You don't have to be on my side, but you need to be on the side of people like me. And I tie this into something that is used in politics, but I don't think it's used very well. And I point, this is my friend John Haidt, who teaches at NYU, who's associated with this, which is people care about fairness. I mean, when I look at tax policy, the problem is you can't argue, oh, you should support this tax policy because it's good for you. People are much more responsive to the argument, you should support this tax policy because it's fair. Now let's take a step back and ask a fundamental question you haven't asked. Why is inequality bad?
That's where I was just going. Yeah, why right. Is inequality bad?
Right. So what you see on the right is an argument that says, well, inequality isn't bad in itself. What's bad is to the extent it causes people at the bottom to not have opportunity, right? And that's on the right. But, you know, on the left, I think there is a misguided argument that is quite similar, which is we need to take care of the poorest. It's the care argument that what's fair is we need to care for the members of our society, blah, blah, blah. You know, look, people, we can see in a pandemic, for instance, you know, you do care about people who are suffering through no fault of their own. But I'll tell you, the moment that people think, well, but there is some fault involved, whether this person got sick because they didn't wear a mask or that person did something else. So I think the narrative, to come back to, I think, the core of your question, what is the narrative that needs to be communicated? You know, I have a narrative. I'm not sure it's the narrative that I would communicate. My narrative is inequality is bad in and of itself. And the reason inequality is bad is because people who are very unequal find it very difficult to trust each other. So what's happened over time is inequality has created a trust deficit in our society. And I would point to, you know, this whole argument about fake news and nobody agrees with, you know, what the truth is or the facts are. I mean, if you want an indication that we've got a serious trust problem in this country, that seems to me to be a pretty obvious one. So inequality creates a lack of trust. Now, I think that's kind of an intellectual, more subtle argument that wouldn't resonate with many voters. But I do think there is an argument. So all right, let me go into a weird place. So there is currently a debate in Congress about extension of unemployment benefits. And apparently the Trump administration, for reasons that baffle a lot of observers, is arguing that instead of increasing unemployment benefits, we should just do a check for everybody, just as we did in March, okay? And a lot of observers make exactly this argument. Why would we give money to everybody? Let's give money to the people who need it through no fault of their own, people who've lost a job, right? And I get that argument. On the other hand, I also see why this argument of let's just give money to everybody equally is so powerful. You know, I think what we've lost sight of in this country is truly the notion of citizenship. You know, citizenship in the sense that citizenship comes with responsibilities and rights, or really, you know, responsibilities and benefits, right? You have to pay, but you get a benefit, right? So, for example, I've frequently argued to me, again, as you noted, I'm a member of Patriotic Millionaires. We think we're patriotic because we think it is a responsibility of all Americans to pay their taxes. And we think it's a particularly important responsibility for those who've benefited the most from the system. So that's fine. But on the right side, what do you get as a citizen? I think there is a problem with the way we focus our benefits on the needy rather than on all citizens. If you contrast the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, with what happens in European societies, in America, we put up, because people were lacking insurance, we put together a very jury-rigged and complicated system to help poorer people afford insurance. In Europe, you just get insurance. Everybody gets insurance. And frankly, again, from a pure fairness, I think part of the argument is, you know, one of the things you're seeing on Republican supporters or opponents of Obamacare is, you know, if you're making, you know, I don't even know where the limits are, but if you're making just above the amount that it takes to get some benefit from Obamacare, and you're looking at the expense of healthcare without any help whatsoever, and contrasting it to somebody who makes less money than you do, is poorer than you, but gets a bigger benefit, I think that is galling to people. So I really do think we need to, it is kind of a New Deal idea, New Deal conceptually, that we need to reestablish this idea of citizenship, that, you know, everybody gets the same kind of benefits. And again, I personally think this should extend to like the idea, I mean, again, it's crazy for me to get Social Security or you know, Medicare, for example, because I could afford to pay for it myself. But I think it's a good thing that I'm part of this system, that I'm treated as a citizen. Because I come back to what concerns me about America. We're moving in a direction where we're not all in it together. And I don't think that works very well for societies. We're moving in a direction where the rich and the poor occupy different societies and don't really interact. We have no social connection. Our children don't play together because they go to different schools. They're never going to get married because they, I mean, we are heading towards, it's not even a two-tier society. It's going to be a multi-tier society. And I believe we're all Americans. We should all be in it together. And we need to rethink this whole idea.
Yeah, you know, I'm glad you took it here, and I'd like to keep diving in this a little more, but we can maybe by pulling out a little bit, but keeping in the subject of, you mentioned that we're jury-rigging certain systems like healthcare, whereas there's just better formats. And then Trump's suggested implementation of checks to everyone is perhaps that good intention of it's equal. It's trying to get rid of this inequality, but from a totally jury-rigged way of just helicopter money.
Let me make a point. Doing that it cannot be jury-rigged.
Exactly.
In the sense of jury-rigged is actually there. In the sense of it's so simple. That's the beauty of a system like that. The government finds it very easy to send out checks to people to figure out if you have the right level of income or too much, and they'll only send it to the people who deserve. That's hard. So it's simplicity as well as you know, psychological resonance.
Mm-hmm. And so I guess what I'm getting at is, We've got this system that's not operating well. It's supposed to be an engine. It's supposed to be an economy. It's supposed to be citizenship where we have equal trust, and therefore we have equal opportunities. And yet everything is out of whack. And so and we're clearly on a trajectory of all these metrics are worsening. We're not just like skyrocketing out of this right now. Do you think we can fine-tune and fix the system with continued rigging and re-rigging? Or do we kind of need some type of cleansing and recycling to build a new system before we can perhaps move on to a more equitable and more vibrant nation and citizenry.
Yeah. So again, let me take a step back. You know, I've been doing this for 20 years as a member of this group, Patriotic Millionaire. As you're aware, I've had, you know, some fairly well-observed things. So I've gotten a lot of comments over the years, many of them negative, but, you know, some incredibly positive and frequently of the sort of, oh, you're such a good person for doing this, you know, that you rich person could just do, you know, could argue for yourself, but you're trying to help other people. And I mean, far be it for me to denigrate anyone who wants to think of me as a particularly philanthropic person. But I got to be honest, when I think about my reasons for doing this, they're not really philanthropic. They're more a recognition of, I feel like, you know what, as I like to say, my family hasn't lived the American dream. We've lived the American fantasy. And, you know, I recognize how good I have it. I mean, my situation is fantastic. So a lot of what I've been doing is feeling like, you know, the real risk that we run is social collapse, social turmoil. I think a lot more people are thinking along those lines now. I've been thinking along those lines for 25 years. And as a beneficiary of the society, wealthy beneficiary of American society, I really should be willing to pay insurance money basically against social collapse. So I view what I'm arguing as in my own self-interest. Okay. And to tie it into the question you asked, I mean, almost pretty much by definition, when I explain to you, well, that's why I'm doing this, that's not a revolutionary perspective. The last thing I want is revolution, because revolution challenges my great position in society. So I'm very much in favor of evolutionary development rather than revolutionary development. Now, I will fully acknowledge I've begun to wonder whether that's possible, whether you really need the kind of revolutionary fervor to overwhelm the incredible power that the wealthy are able to establish. But you know, that doesn't mean change can't come. It's hard, the slow boring of hard wood, but it can come. And let me give you, again, a very concrete example of the way I envision it coming, which is to tap into these ideas about fairness. So let me go back to my conception of what it means to be an American, what we mean by the American dream, right? The American dream, to me, and again, it's not well defined, but the American dream is basically the idea that every individual in America should have the opportunity to make the most of themselves, regardless of family background or, you know, the peculiarities of your situation. If you have the ability and are willing to make the effort, you should have the opportunity to succeed. And I think I'm not a politician, and the last thing I want to do is be a politician, but I think that's a message and a story that resonates with a lot of people. And so the problem then is, okay, do we have that system now? Hell no. Clearly, the wealthy have a lot more opportunity to succeed than the poor. And by the way, let me be clear, that's always going to be true. I mean, I'm not, again, as a practical matter, you know, we've never seen a classless society. However, it's not true today. We need to fix it. So one of my arguments for an estate tax has been, again, to try and tap into, when I first registered to vote, I registered as a Republican back in 1980. I mean, that party has just moved so far away from what I believe they're all about. Because again, originally, that to me was part of Republicanism. I do believe in individual, you know, effort and responsibility. I'm all over that stuff. But when Paul Ryan, the former Speaker of the House of Representatives, you know, complained about welfare, he wanted to lower welfare because he felt that, you know, it created a hammock for the poor, that, you know, it's just too easy to just take your welfare money and not work. My reaction coming from my perspective is, well, you know, Paul, I agree with you. I think that is a definite problem with welfare. I think it's much better for people to earn their own money. But why are you only worried about poor kids? I mean, you want the biggest welfare program on the planet. It's rich kids who inherit millions of dollars. That's welfare. So my view is an inheritance tax is really basically a way of saying, hey, if you want to provide private welfare for your own kids, that's fine. I don't have a problem with you doing that, but you should also contribute to the public welfare of other kids who don't have those same opportunities. A tax that links the idea that you're giving this thing to your kids to help them along, well, guess what? There are a lot of other American kids who need to be helped along as well. When you give it to that kid, you're going to give an equal amount to other kids as well. Now, have I succeeded with this argument? Hell no. I've been at this for 20 years and I've lost repeatedly. But you keep fighting the battle, and that to me is an argument that at least has the potential of winning. And again, because at the end of the day, it's not, to my mind, a partisan argument.
And
it
so
really isn't.
And so you're mentioning that you 20 years ago, you know, I notice what's going on here. This is just my insurance policy. I think everyone should be doing against social upheaval or revolution. And then now your perspective is a little more worrisome. If you were just to take your finger on the pulse today from your insights and perspectives, where do you see us on that trajectory? Is how much hope do you have that we can slowly evolve this? And then like a real rational look at it, how much do you think would you say that you're like actually worried for some type of upheaval at this point?
I'm very worried. Yeah, I am very worried. I start with a very different perspective, though, than I think most people. Although, as I said, it seems like over the last few years, a lot more people have gravitated towards my perspective, which is, I think most people, you know, like the old Robert Kennedy line goes, you know, most people look at the world as it is. Well, actually, let me paraphrase the old Robert Kennedy line. Most people look at the world as it is and just say, well, of course it's that way. And so people look at America, you know, our two century history of being a model democracy, and have long assumed that, well, that's just the way it is. We've got the stuff to be, you know, I never have done that. I feel that the default of the human condition is chaos. It is extremely difficult to create a coherent group that gets along and can accomplish its goals. And the bigger the group, the harder it is. So at one level, the idea of a functioning democracy of 350 million people is absurd. And certainly when they started it, many of the founders thought that as well. So I begin with, this stuff is really hard, and we're always on the edge of chaos. Now, the good news about taking that perspective is, you know, it gives you a little more, well, of course it's always going to, you know, are we in a bad situation? Yeah, but it's always going to be a bad situation. It's never going to get better. I mean, it's never going to go away. I shouldn't say it never gets better. Of course I want it to get better. But I'm not aiming for nirvana. And let me go back to my perspective, right? Again, I think of myself, whether other people agree or not, as a pretty pragmatic person. You know, again, I don't believe in nirvana. I don't believe in you know, perfection. I believe everything is like, let's just try and make things, I believe in continuous improvement. Let's just try and make things a little better. So again, right now, I'm just saying, look, inequality is a problem and government is making it worse. Let's stop. So, you know, very simply, arguments around taxes, the way the tax system benefits the rich, let's at least get to a tax system that does not overwhelmingly benefit the rich. Is that nirvana or perfection? No. Is it better than where we are? Yeah.
I want to ask about generations real fast. So I'll bring in my perspective as a millennial, and as I try to frame this when I'm thinking about these things.
How old are you, Brad?
33. And so my father's a boomer. You know, we've got these generational cohorts moving through their phases of life. And as millennials are coming more and more into not just the workforce, but into their more prime earning years, and then we'll soon begin to moving into more political and powerful roles that are actually shaping policy and culture even more so. And I worry that millennials, we grew up only knowing this somewhat unraveling phase. And we were told the American dream. But then we grow up and we're in the real world and we don't see anywhere. All we see is inequality, racism, bailouts, and things are getting worse. And so we're like, what is this dream? And so I think exactly what you mentioned, it's so hard. We underestimate but we also underappreciate this thing we have in America where there's this cohesive nation that at points has worked very well together. And so it seems like a central part of that is a very strong narrative and story and a trust in that narrative and story. And so I worry that this big generational cohort doesn't believe in the story, doesn't believe in the narrative. Right. And they'll just seek to tear it down because this thing seems divisive and unhealthy. How can we change? Is that even possible to get a generation like mine to believe in this narrative that seems antiquated and not based in reality? Is that even possible? And if so, like, what's your experience with the work that you've done?
Well, I definitely think it's possible. And the reason I think it's possible is because it's not simply that people are responsive to narrative, but they need one.
We need narrative.
Right? They need one. They want one. People want, you know, people need meaning in their life. And you know, this is a big, you know, potential source of meaning. So it's possible because the latent demand or desire is there. But again, I go back to, it's always hard. And you know, I mean, one thing about growing older, although I think I've always had some of this, which is you get a more historical perspective, you know, and I will simply contrast your situation to somebody who, well, let's go a little bit younger than you. You know, if you think about the 60s, when young people were looking at a world that, a society that they felt had gone seriously astray, but no small part of that was it was sending them to die in a war that they didn't believe in. There was no story that they bought about that war by the late 60s, right? You know, you say, well, are things really worse today than they were? You know, again, I was talking to a friend of mine who's a little bit older than me. I mean, I was a young child in 1968, but he was asking, you know, he's saying, you know, have we ever been this close to collapse? And I said, well, you must remember 1968. I don't exactly remember it, but certainly everything I've seen about 1968 makes me feel like, my God, we were a lot closer to collapse then. I mean, assassinations, right? Robert Kennedy, Martin Luther King, a war going on. So, you know, let's put it in a little perspective. But yeah, I totally agree. And you know, I think there are these generational components to it. I think your generation has been screwed over. And certainly, you know, with the pandemic, it's just even worse. And we're back to, I mean, you haven't asked me this question point blank, but, you know, it's kind of inherent in this is, well, you know, why am I doing this? Well, because there are lots of, you know, what I'll call idea entrepreneurs out there, right? Or story entrepreneurs who are trying to give kids and lots of people a story. You know, on the right, there's definitely, I mean, Donald Trump is giving you a story, whether you believe it or not, there's a story in what he's saying. And why do I do what I do? Why do I do what I do? Because I have a different story and I'm trying to get that story out there. And I wouldn't be doing it if I didn't think it had a chance of succeeding. But that doesn't mean I'm under any illusion that it's easy. And let me just point to one. So here's a big part of the story. And again, let me also say, you know, the problem with stories, of course, is they're all false. Right. There's an old saying in kind of my academic work, which is all models are false, some models are useful. And it's the exact same thing. All stories are false because the act of creating the story means editing. And that means you're losing. I mean, again, it may not be strictly false. You may not be telling an actual lie, although frequently you will be. But at least the mere fact of editing means there's a lot more to this story that you're not telling. So let's look at the story of America. We've been talking about this American dream, but let's talk about another aspect of this story, which is racial relations in this country. We have now come to realize we have this, we do not have an agreed upon story about how this has evolved in this country. And by the way, we don't even have a story about where we want to go. And again, I will tell you from my perspective, I think one of the ways that the left has gone wrong, again, is this story. Even the, but let me be clear. It is a true story that African Americans have been completely screwed in this country. I just don't think it's a very useful story. And let me tie it now to this. There is plenty of research and plenty of theoretical reason and plenty of just kind of experience to suggest that a core problem with the things I'm talking about, taxation, economic policies, is it intersects with race. Which is to say, there's evidence that says people are a lot more willing to support a more liberal state, higher taxes, more benefits, the more racially homogeneous a society is. That one of America's problems is, unlike the Danes who have, or the Scandinavians who have these, higher welfare states, but they tend to be a pretty coherent ethnic group. In America, we are a country of immigrants. And so, the one, again, it's both a hope and a fear, I guess. My hope is that your generation, the racial issues, I don't know if they're going to go away. But it does seem like your generation is having grown up in a different world than people my age, or particularly people 20 years older than me. That this may not be as it, th that may no longer be as driving a factor. But of course, that's a hope that seems to be belied by recent political events. So, I do think a lot about how that plays. And by the way, again, I'm not alone in thinking this and arguing this. Matt Iglesias, I don't know if you follow, he's a writer and blogger. But a bunch of people have been writing, again, the left is making a mistake. I mean, again, let me be clear, and I go back. African Americans in this country have gotten such a raw deal, it's just beyond unfair. No dispute about that. But again, like reparations, does anyone really believe this is a politically effective approach? Go back to what I'm saying. And again, this is the argument, which is, look, I'm not all about racial issues. I think they're important, but that's not where I am. I'm about inequality. Well, guess what? There's a big overlap between race and inequality, but are you going to solve it by talking more about race? Are you going to solve it by talking more about inequality? My argument is you're going to talk more about inequality because you move beyond this, what is really a fundamental impediment to people's, accepting the story you're telling them about what's going on. So, that's kind of a long-winded and discursive response, but I think it does get at some of the issues you're asking about.
Well, yes, and when you point to race and its overlap with inequality, it has so much to do, at least in my mind, with unhealed wounds in a sense. And so throwing money at a problem or quick band-aid policies when we've lost, bringing it back to a lot of what we talked about this conversation, we've lost trust. And so attempting to repair a friendship with callous words or a little check, things like this, that's not how you repair relationships. And so this country, it's relationally lost that trust. And so how do we rebuild this forgiveness, and how do we restore the citizenry, all these big, deep meaning and relational issues we're talking about. And so, you know, it is an important thing for sure. And there's a lot of countries that have taken many other different routes. You look at Canada and how it deals with its First Nations and reconciliation, all these stuff. It's a really wild topic for sure. And at least for me, it seems like the deep part about it is relationship. And, you know, I'm with you. I hope we can rebuild a nation of trust in ourselves collectively and in a shared vision and dream and narrative. And so hopefully we, through people much like yourself and others, hopefully we can continue to repair and get us back in some kind of collective society that's not completely polarized.
So trust is a very interesting topic, and it's a hard thing to research, though there is some interesting research done around it. But again, there's a general observation that I've found it actually difficult to provide compelling evidence this is true. But once again, it feels so right that it's hard to believe it's not true, which is trust is hard to build, easy to destroy. Mm. So again, if you think about a personal relationship, you have a relationship with a friend, and they do something to violate your trust, what do you do then? Well, you know, partly it depends on the nature of your relationship, but the simple answer is you rebuild that relationship slowly. And, you know, you can't get ahead of yourself. It's going to be a period of time. It's just simple time where, you know, you now can perceive, well, that happened then, but they were trustworthy here, and they're trustworthy here, and they're trustworthy here. And so it's that slow building over time. But, you know, again, let's back up a second. I mean, to the extent... One of my biggest complaints about George W. Bush, about which I had plenty, is, well, you'd be too young, but after 9/11, I mean, there was this really weird period of time for a few weeks. I mean, I remember driving around and, I mean, literally thinking like, you know, basically I would argue that for a few weeks after 9/11, drivers were a lot more polite. That you know, again, trust, you know, depends upon a feeling of, is this person part of my group? Again, is this person somehow like me? Well, that was a moment when we all were reminded, hey, we're all Americans. There are a lot of people out there who don't like us because we're Americans. But that is all the more reason why, you know, we feel this community together. And what I really resented about George W. Bush, instead of taking that moment and going in the kind of direction that I'm saying here, it was the moment where they said, this is a great opportunity for us to take care of our own people. Let's cut taxes on rich people again. And so... So I'm not saying it's easy, but I do think it's possible. And partly it's going to be determined by external events like that. I mean, again, arguably a pandemic might have been a moment like that, but we go back to the political leadership we have. I mean, look, going back to your incentivize, here's a fundamental problem, and it's one of my biggest worries, which is our system incentivizes conflict rather than cooperation. Politicians, and Donald Trump is, you know, the example of this par excellence, are better off trying to create division than unity. And that's just inherent to the system. There's nothing we can do about it. That's the way systems work. And it's a problem. The flip side of it, however, is that person who can come along and recreate that sense of unity, again, people want a story. And let me tell you, people want America people want a great America. Again, it's but patriots. I mean, I love this country. What an amazing country. And I think that love is broad. What we need is to come back again. I personally, for what it's worth, I have come to the conclusion, you know, all this cultural stuff and frankly, a lot of the race stuff really should be pushed aside. I want to focus on the economics. I believe that if we can create an economically more equal society, it will become a lot easier to deal with these other problems. But if we try and deal with those problems first, we're never going to deal with the economics. So, I have begun to wonder, I'm going to leave it at that.
Well, this is why it's so much fun having discussions with you. I could just keep asking questions. And, you know, what you mentioned about 9/11, I think, is so fascinating because it was a time where the country came together. The dark side.
It wanted to come together, but it never got there.
No. And the dark side is it's because there was a common enemy. And.
Yes.
And so that's.
Yeah.
That's almost, and there's so much study on this, that the best unifying factor for a group of people is a common enemy, not yeah. a common goal
yeah.
or positive yeah. outlook, which is, you ended it so lightly and then I took it dark again, but that's the nature of the world we live in. And so ignoring these things
Let me lighten it a little bit. I don't disagree with you, and I've thought a lot about that and wondered about it. And just as a very quick aside, there's a great old, it was originally a science fiction book called The Lathe of Heaven. I think I'm getting this story right. And it got turned into a TV show, and it was about a guy. It was basically the conceit was it was a guy who was going to see a therapist, and he had these very vivid dreams that were bothering him. And eventually the therapist realized that this guy was having these vivid dreams, and whatever he dreamed became reality. And so the therapist decides he wanted to try and implant ideas to kind of guide it in a direction. And one of them is, you know, we want peace. Well, of course, the way you create peace is alien, you know, an alien invasion force. So I get your point. However, again, an enemy doesn't need to be a person or a group. Climate change. Now, I will admit, it's not that easy to create the story to conceptualize climate change as an enemy in the way people want to hear it. But I do think it's possible. And yeah, I mean, we're back to the heart of the issue, which is we need to believe and we want to believe we're in this together. And right now, there is just not that belief.
Yeah, that's a good point. Well, thanks for lightening up a bit at the end there.
Well, again, I'm a philosophical. I just saw a great. There's a guy I follow who's an investment advisor . And he gave this dictum that you should invest like a, you should save, yeah, that's right. He said, you should save like a pessimist, but invest like an optimist.
I like that. So,
I would say that, you know, I am ultimately a pessimist. I am a pessimist in the way I think about the future and the way I plan for the future, but I'm an optimist in what I actually do about the future, right? You have to have that. You have to believe that you can be efficacious in whatever you're doing. And I'm under no illusion how hard it is, but what choice do you really have?
Yeah,
you
know? I completely agree. Plan for the worst, but live for the best.
Yeah. And so, you know, again, I do want to end on a positive note because I go back to this idea that, you know, that's all of us individually, but what humans are really trying to do is form that connection with other people. And boy, oh boy, actually, so I will, I'm going to give you, I used to end my class with this story. So I will end this.
Wonderful.
Story. So there's a guy, he's at Carnegie Mellon, I think. And he's like a computer scientist. I can't even remember how I got turned on because it was like a recorded lecture that he had done. I didn't know the guy. I don't even remember why I decided, oh, this looks interesting. But he was the lecture was talking about the problems of, the guy is a researcher and he's interested in CAPTCHAs, which is how you can tell if somebody's human or not. And then the talk kind of veered off into a related topic, which is indexing of images on the web, which is a really hard problem, actually, you know, because we don't have the technology that allows us to create things. So they created this little website. It's a very clever little idea. And what it was a website you go to, and it would show, it was a way to tap into humans for free to get them to do the indexing you needed by assigning keywords to an image. So what would happen is you would go to this website, and it would anonymously connect you to somebody else who was at the website. And both of you would be shown an image, a picture. And the game was to then type in words that related to that image and picture. And you won the game when you and the person you'd paired with had typed in three of the same word. Huh. Now you can, it's a very clever idea for how you put and assign keywords to an image, because I might randomly choose some bizarre word, but if you and I are sitting there and we both assign the same word to this image, chances are not bad that, you know, that's probably a useful word around this image. Okay, but none of that was relevant to me. None of it is interesting about the story. What was interesting to me about the story was the anecdote he went on to tell, which is he said, you know, we set up this website. We didn't really know who would be interested in playing this stupid little game. And we found there was a great deal of interest. And in fact, at the extreme, we found people who were spending hours sitting there playing this stupid game. And we were trying to understand why, and we're not entirely sure, but I will tell you this. We get a lot of emails from people saying, oh, you know, I was hooked up with this random person, and I'm wondering if you could give me their email. Because I really felt that we were just on the same wavelength, and I'd love to meet, you know, talk to this person.
Oh, my goodness.
And I'm sitting there thinking, boy, if you want an example of how strongly humans desire to what in psychological terms we call share reality, there it is. We really want to share reality. We want to share stories with other people. Now, you're absolutely right that we do that in part as a competitive element. But because that motivation is a little obscure to us, again, I go back to why I'm cautiously optimistic, because people want stories. They want to connect. And all I'm really arguing for is, you know, let's create a society that makes it easier for people to connect.
Let's do it. Let's leave it there. I think that was wonderful. Thank you so much for your time. This has been a real treat. Here at the Empire's New Clothes, we believe something big is in America's future. But we don't quite know what. If you'd like to continue the journey with us, like, subscribe, and let us know who you want us to interview next in the comments below. This next decade is going to be crazy. So join us as we try to figure out what's going on, and I look forward to seeing you next week.